There is nothing new in people migrating to different countries and continents for better prospects. Once they are uprooted from their native land, they will be deprived of the belongingness or the feeling of belongingness to their mother country. At the same time, they have another problem that they will find it very difficult to adjust to the new cultural scenario in which they have migrated to. This is actually the feeling of being a diaspora. A diaspora is a community which are originally migrated to another country. They have taken citizenship in that particular country in which they are living, but at the same time they always crave for a travel back to their homeland. But because of many other socio-cultural or financial issues, they might not be able to do that. This is the real feeling of being a diaspora. So today we will be discussing the poem Indian Movie New Jersey, written by Chitra Banerjee Divakaruni. She is an Indian American writer. She is presently working as a professor in one of the colleges in America. She is a poet, novelist, and a short story writer. She is equally proficient in all these three genres, and she is very famous for her three novels. They are Mistress of Spices, Sister of My Heart, and Palace of Illusions. This Mistress of Spices, probably you might have seen, it had been adapted to a Bollywood movie. It was enacted by, the main actress was Aishwarya Rai, so Indian media had given a good coverage for the same. So this is all about the poet. So the thing is that there are enormous number of South Asians who had migrated to Europe and North America. And the thing with this particular migrated community is that each group shares a collective identity in the country in which they have migrated to. And within that country itself, there might be large number of migrants in such continents, especially in America, which we know that there are people all around the world have migrated to America. At some point of time in history, people always prefer to migrate to America, thinking that they will have a better future there. So these people, when they are in an alien country, I use the term alien because it is not their original motherland. So here we are talking about the first generation migrant. So when they reach that host country, what they do is that they will have a collective identity, and they will have a feeling of togetherness. And this particular feeling of togetherness among this migrant community is what is being discussed in the poem Indian Movie New Jersey. The setting of the poem is a movie theater in New Jersey. New Jersey is a place in America where there are a large number of migrants, especially Indians, living. And the major themes in this poem is the complications of Indian experience in America. Being an Indian in America, or being an American Indian, that is the major theme, one of the major themes. And the next one is the feeling of isolation and homesickness of immigrants in general. Here the characters or the narrator is an Indian immigrant, and from the narration we get to know that the narrator is a first generation migrant. What do you mean by first generation migrant? First generation migrant are the people who originally migrated to another country, not their children, the first people who migrated to another country. So the feeling of isolation among this first, or homesickness among this first generation migrants. The poem is divided into four stanzas, or no, four sections or four stanzas, and it consists of 52 lines. As I have already mentioned, the story or the poem is taking place, or it is set in a movie theater in New Jersey, where a group of Indians are watching a typical Indian movie which brings about the feeling of being an Indian. So they are watching an Indian movie, probably it will be a Bollywood movie, and the peculiarity of that theater or that screening is that all the audiences are Indian audience, and the people who can really understand the sensibility of being an Indian, they know what is to be an Indian. So it won't be all the Indian movies won't be screened there. There might be very few theaters which will be screening the Indian movies. But the thing, see, the interesting thing is that every or majority of the people who could go there, who can find time to go there, they will watch this movie. The interesting thing about this movie screening is that everyone who have gathered there are ready to accept the flows and accept the movie as it is. Unlike an audience back here in India, probably if the same movie is being watched by the people who are living in India at that particular time, probably they will find many flaws in it because we are very used to it. But the thing is that this feeling this particular community shares is that they are ready to accept any flaws of them, so that because it actually arouses the feeling of being an Indian, and that is the only thing which they need. All the other material aspects, they don't even consider it as important. So we will move on to the poem. As I already said, it is divided into four sections. So I will recite the poem, the whole poem in the beginning. Later on, we will discuss each and every section in detail. Not like the white film stars, all rib and gown cheekbone, the Indian sex goddess smiles plumply from behind a flowery branch. Below her brief red skirt, her thighs are solid and redeeming as tree trunks. She swings her hips and the men viewers whistle. The lover hero dances into a song. His lips sing a little off, but no matter. We know the words already and sing along. It is safe here, the day golden and cool, so no one sweats. Roses on every bush and the Dal Lake clean again. The sex goddess switches to thickened English to emphasize a joke. We laugh and clap. Here we need not be embarrassed by mispronounced phrases dropping like hot lead into foreign ears. The flickering movie light wipes from our faces years of America. Sons who want mohawks and refuse to run family store. Daughters who date on the sly. When at the end the hero dies for his friend who also loves the sex goddess and now can marry her, we weep understandingly. Even the men clear their throats to say, what kubani, what dosti. After, we mill around, unwilling to leave, exchange greetings and good news, a new gold chain, a trip to India. We do not speak of motel rates, cancel permits, stones thrown through glass windows, daughters and sons raped by doorbusters. In this dim foyer, we can pull around us the faint comforting smell of incense and pakoras. can arrange our children's marriage with hometown boys and girls, open a franchisee, win a million in the mail. We can retire in India, a yellow two-storied house with wrought iron gates, our own ambassador car. Or at least move to a rich, white suburb, Summerfield or Fort Lee, with neighbors that will talk to us. Here, while the film songs still echo in the corridors and restrooms, we can trust in movie truths. Sacrifice, success, love and luck. The America that was supposed to be. Now we will analyze each stanza in detail. So, the story in a nutshell of the poem is that it is a description of a Bollywood movie or an Indian movie. Nowhere it is said that it is a Bollywood movie or a Hindi movie, but we assume that it is a Hindi movie, and the story is narrated. The dance sequence is explained, the appearance of the heroine is explained, metaphor is used to describe, the metaphor used to describe the beauty of the heroine is sex goddess. So it doesn't have any wrong implication. The poet is using this word again, and this is a recurring word in the poem. The poet is using this word again and again to say that, or just to compare that this Indian heroine is extremely beautiful, and everyone wants to be like that, her. So that is why she is called a sex goddess, and there is an extremely beautiful heroine. And the story from which, the story of that particular movie which we get to know from the poem is that it is, there are two heroes in the movie, a heroine and two men, or the two heroes were in love with that girl, but the thing is that since these boys were, or these heroes were friends, one person was hiding his feelings towards this heroine, and towards the end of the movie, this the main hero dies, and the second hero gets a chance to marry this heroine, and finally it is a happy ending movie wherein everyone applauds, or everyone is carried away by the way the movie is being narrated. So that is the story of the movie which we get from the poem. And in the first stanza, it is a detailed description of the setting of a typical Indian commercial movie. And the first stanza describes a song sequence, and the very first line starts with a description or a comparison between the English heroines and Indian heroines. The poem begins with a description of an English heroine, or basically a comparison of English and an Indian heroine. The English heroine is compared or described as gowned. Gowned simply means bony, or a girl with a bony cheek. So she is so slim, that is what we understand. So unlike the English slim beauty concept, the Indian heroines are plummy. We always liked, in fact, a pre-globalization India always acknowledged being healthy as beautiful. It is after globalization, the very concept of being slim as beauty became popular in India. So that is how the poem begins. Not like the white film stars, all rib and gaunt cheekbone. The Indian sex gods smiles plumply behind a flowery branch. So then there is a description of a song sequence there, wherein she is wearing an unconventional dress, a very short dress, and she is dancing along with the hero. And she is very healthy from the narration which we get, and she is dancing. So the dance sequence is very much important in a Bollywood movie that's very popular among the audience. Probably that is the reason why the dances and songs, Bollywood dances and songs, are very much popular. And the dance, the lover hero, or the hero and heroine, are dancing together, and while the hero is singing, his lips are not singing properly. His lips are not singing properly, and the audience get to know that, okay, he is not singing, or his lips are not singing properly to the real song. But we don't mind. We Indian audience don't mind about it, because we never consider perfection as very much important as far as a movie is considered, and we already knew the songs. Because songs become very popular even before the release of a movie. So we know the songs. So even if the hero is not singing it properly on screen, we don't mind, because we are only concerned about the lyrics of the poem, and we have taken that lyrics, or we have taken that lyrics to our heart, or the song to our heart. So we don't have any heart feelings because the hero is not acting properly. Because the very concept of perfection, the very concept of perfection was a Western concept. We never were not very particular of being perfect, especially in these movies and such art forms, because we never had an idealized image of a movie, because we knew that we are ready to accept the flaws of a narration in a movie. And that is why we don't, even though the lover hero's lips are not singing properly, the narrator, our narrator, is saying that we don't mind, we were singing along with the hero, so that we could compensate the error committed by the hero. Then in the last four lines, we get an idealized image of Kashmir, because if you go through the movies, so the movies in 1980s and 1990s, almost all Bollywood movies, there will be one song sequence where which is taken on the background of this Dal Lake in Kashmir. That's a very beautiful scene, scenery, and that can be the reason why in almost all the movies, all the romantic songs are taken on that background. So an idealized image of Kashmir is given there, and it is safe here. He's saying that it is safe here. At that time it was safe, and it was so beautiful, or Kashmir was so beautiful, it aroused every feeling of belongingness among the audience who were watching, or the viewers who were watching the movie, or it have taken them back to their homeland, which they have left behind, they have left behind long back. So that is all about in the first stanza, wherein a comparison between Indian movie and English movie is made, especially comparison in the physical appearance of women is used, wherein the beauty standards are different. The poet is saying that the beauty standards are different, and the poet is not at all, or the narrator is not at all impressed by the skinny beauty ideology of the Westerners, and she prefers a plummy beauty, plummy Indian beauty in fact. So that is what we get in the first stanza, wherein we are introduced to the movie as well as the feeling of the audience or the viewers to that movie. And in the second stanza, we will move on to the second stanza. A comic sequence in the movie is described, wherein the heroine is using a thickened English. So thickened English is simply an accented form of English. Thickened English, that is a word used by the poet. Thickened English. It was a comic scene wherein the heroine is trying to be English, and she is faking a wrong accent, or wrong pronunciation, and it aroused the comic effect among the viewers. But what our poet is saying, that we were able to enjoy the beauty of that comic scene to its core, and we are not judgmental there. We are not judgmental there because we know that it is difficult for an Indian to speak like an English. So, but they are, she is saying that, or the narrator is saying that, we are not at all embarrassed by the mispronounced phrases, because in this America, when these Indians have migrated, the natives or the native speakers of English in America always make, we get to know that, we understood, we can understand from this particular line that they are being mocked by the native speaker for their accented language, because definitely a non-native speaker of any language will find it difficult to learn probably they will be able to learn the language, but when you pronounce it, when you speak a different second language, there will be lots of errors in it. And from the poem we get to know that these people always, the native speakers or the first language users, always made fun of these people because they are migrants. So here we get a hint that in a migrant or in the host country, a migrant is not considered as the real citizen of the nation. They don't get that acknowledgement in the host country. And the flickering movie light wipes from our faces years of America. What do you mean by the flickering? The sparkling, the happiness, the sparkling movie, actually it helps them to the audience get so immersed in the movie, so that it helps them to forget the pains they have to undergo in this alien land. Oh, they can easily forget their problems, their marginalizations in the host country. And being an immigrant is not an easy task. This is what we can understand from, this is the pathos of the narrator which reflected in these lines, wherein the narrator is assuring himself or herself that okay, we as a community are here, we as a community are enjoying the Indianness at least through the movies, and there is no one, at least in this movie theater, to judge us or judge our culture. And then the other pain or the other problem, one of the major problems of these immigrants is described in the last two lines, wherein their children are being, we get to know the attitude of their children. Children means the second generation migrants. What do you mean by second generation migrants? So the parents have already settled down there in some foreign country, so they have a feeling of belongingness to their homeland. But the children, they are born and brought up in that host country. So for them, it is their homeland. Maybe through appearance, they look like an Indian. Probably they will look like an Indian. Definitely they will look like an Indian. But the thing that their sensibility is being an American, or their feeling of belongingness is to their country in which they are born and brought up, because they have their education there, their friends are belong to that particular country. So they do not have anything to do with the homeland, or the, when we are talking about Indian diasporic people, these children doesn't have any feeling towards their parents' mother country. And the children who wants to be Mohawk, so that is a word used. So Mohawk is actually a tribal community in America, but this particular word is popular through the hairstyle of these people who lived in that community. That hairstyle, we are also very familiar with that hairstyle, that the sides of your head will be shaven and you will be spikes in the center portion. You look like a rooster. What do you mean by rooster? പൂവങ്കോഴിയെ പോലെ ഇരിക്കുന്ന മുടി വെട്ടി നടക്കുന്ന പച്ച കളറും ചുമല കളറും ഒക്കെ അടിക്കുന്ന ആ ഒരു ഹെയർ സ്റ്റൈൽ. സോ ദാറ്റ് ഇസ് എ ടിപ്പിക്കൽ. സോ ദീസ് പീപ്പിൾ ഓർ ദ ചിൽഡ്രൻ ഓൾവേസ് വോണ്ടഡ് ടു be different from their, probably these children are their tastes are different which their parents cannot understand, and the thing is that the sons in the name of fashion they are using these type of hairstyles or their dressing style. Everything is anglicized. It's a completely different cultural feeling, or the value system they uphold is different. And their daughters who date on cunningly date with a foreigner without their parents knowing it, and in these all are their problems, the problems of being an immigrant in a foreign country wherein their children no longer belongs to them. The children cannot identify with the feelings of the parents. So the poet is, or the narrator is saying that during this a short period of time while watching a movie, they completely get immersed in the movie, so that for 2 or 3 hours they are able to forget their pains in the foreign land. Then the poet is moving on to the third stanza, wherein she is concluding what happened to the hero and heroine in the story. What happened is that there were, as I have already mentioned, there were two heroes. Both of them were in love with the girl, but one person was hiding his love towards the girl, and finally the main hero dies and the second hero gets a heroine, and everyone was ready to appreciate the poignant or the pathos or the real love that is being narrated in the movie. Probably for an American audience or an English audience, the theme itself of the movie itself might be funny for them, because for them their value system regarding the life and your choices are completely different. But everyone is saying that what a qurbani, what a dosti, that is the way you should be. That is the real sense of life. You sacrificing yourself for your friend is the greatest achievement a person can have. And finally the movie is over, and after that the narrator is saying that we mill around. Mill around means, simply means, they gather around, and it is a community, or that the audience, as mentioned earlier, they belong to the Indian community who like to watch Indian movies, and then they gather around, they have a get together there, they will talk about their happinesses there. They talk only about their happinesses. So what all are their happinesses? That is the interesting thing, because everyone is unwilling to leave. They exchange their greetings and good news. And what is the good news? You buying a new gold chain, because we are all familiar with the Indians' love towards the yellow metal gold, and the trip to India. So that is another happiness. When are you going to India? When are you going to visit your homeland? So these all are their small happiness, happinesses in their life, and they will have a chit chat there for some time. But one thing is that whatever they discuss is connected to Indian experience alone. They are not ready to discuss their life in America or the problems they are facing in the host country during that happy occasion or that happy hour. I would like to rather like to say that they don't discuss about their problems in the host country, the problems they are facing in the host country or in the foreign land, and they have many problems. So what are the problems they actually have to face? These all are the serious issue. We do not speak of motel raids, cancel permits, stones thrown through the glass windows, daughters and sons raped by dotbusters. So these all are grave issues, but they don't want to talk about such things there, because they know that everyone is facing such problems there in the foreign land, and the foreigners or the people in the host country, they are not compassionate towards them. They will never ever show any sort of compassion towards them, and they don't want to express, or they don't want to share their sorrows with the community, the Indian community, because it is a happy occasion and they don't want to spoil the situation. They don't want to be a spoil sport. So they only talk about the happinesses, the little bit happinesses they have in their life. And the movie is over, then everyone moves out of the like movie hall where it is screened, and there is a dim foyer. What do you mean by dim foyer? An a hall or an entrance where people are able to gather, where you in like hope all of you have been to a movie theater where you will buy this what juices or refreshments. So there will be a foyer there. So in the dim foyer, what they do is that they will buy certain pakoras. Pakoras is a snack, Indian snack. Since the Indian movie is screened, probably they will get Indian snacks from there. Then the incense or the scents, or it's a very perfumed hall, and it is there because all the Indian community is there. The parents try to arrange a marriage alliance with some other Indians over there who have settled down there. They talk about such things, and finally they will talk about their retirement plans. They will assume that probably one day when they think that they have saved enough for their future, they will go back and settle down in India. So these all are the biggest dreams of them. So that is the paradox of the situation. So before they were moving on to another country, they were thinking that they will be very happy in the other country because the country is rich and they think that the money is the most important thing. But now what they are dreaming is that they want to come back. They want to come back, and they thinking about having a house of their own, a two-storied house, a car of their own in India. Then they know that, okay, this is not practically going to be possible. So they are thinking that at least, okay, probably we will be able to move to a better area where the neighbors won't judge them on the basis of the ethnicity they belong to. And so they are talking about such things. So these are the points of discussion in that dim foyer. And finally, people started to leave the room, and the film song is still echoing through the corridor of the theater, which we know that, okay, in every theater, even before and after the screening of the movie, the songs from that particular movie will be played in the theater, the corridors of the theater or the restrooms. Then we can trust in movie truth. So that line is very much important. We can trust in movie truths. Sacrifice, success, love and luck, the America that was supposed to be. So here, a concept known as American dream is questioned. American dream. So American dream is a belief. It is a capitalist ideology, and it is a belief that anyone, in regardless where they belong to, which class they belong to, they can attain their own version of success. Because success, being successful, is the motto of a capitalist community, and that was the reason why people migrated. People in large number migrated to America, because there, if you are ready to work, you will be able to earn as much as money as you. They don't have a classification of your status on the basis of the work you are doing. So that the belief that anyone can be successful regardless of your ethnicity or your community or a class, and the upward mobility is possible for everyone. So that is the very concept known as American dream. And you can achieve success only through sacrifice, risk taking and hard work. You see, if you are ready to work hard, if you are ready to sacrifice your life, and if you have the risk taking capacity, anyone can be successful in America. So that is the what you mean by this American dream, very concept of American dream. So people migrate to America pursuing this particular dream. And we think that, okay, if there is no differentiation on the basis of the work you are doing, then what is the problem? I can earn money as much as I can. So that is why people have migrated to America. But the point is questioning. It was supposed to be the American dream, but the love and luck doesn't have anything to do with American dream, because Americans never, in this very concept of American dream, luck has nothing to do with your life. If you are hardworking enough, you will be able to, you will be successful. Otherwise, you won't be successful. And the very emotion, the very emotion known as love is not celebrated there, where people do not have time to love. But the movie, the themes which the movie, which they have watched, portrayed all these things, success, love, luck and sacrifice. Everything was there in the movie, and it was also supposed to be the American dream, and which now the narrator knows is that which the narrator knows is wrong. So finally, the poet is concluding on a very sad note that we audience or the we readers get a feeling that the narrator is not at all happy in the new land, and they have pursued this so-called American dream. But finally, they understood the reality of the American dream. That's all about the poem. Go through the poem. We will have a discussion later.